Cup 2013. I'm Stephen Stamp alongside of Mark Amendolia, and we will be bringing you the semifinal, the Guelph Gryphons and the Brock Badgers, and this should be a dandy of a game. These two teams met twice during the regular season. Brock won the first one fairly handily, but the second was a one-goal game, Brock taking it. There are the goalies, Jeremy Snyder for Guelph, Ian Duffy for Brock. Tap hands, and we are about ready to go, and this is going to be a terrific game.
Yeah, we're looking at the regular season standings for 2013, and we were just talking about it, actually. The West playing an extra two games, 12 instead of the 10 in the East. And the reason for that, as Stephen told me earlier, was because there are more teams actually playing in the West. You have Laurier, Laurentian, Toronto, McMaster, Guelph, Western, and Brock as the number one seed with an 11-1 record. And then in the East, obviously McGill, who just played against Queens. And then you have Bishops, Trent, Carleton, and Concordia, making up only six teams. So that's why you have those extra games.
Brock comes up with the first ball. Kyle Kropman taking the faceoffs for the Brock Badgers. He was a honorable mention All-Canadian. He will be facing off, though, against Ben Van Galen for Guelph, who was the All-Canadian faceoff specialist, and also the All-Canadian long stick midfield and an honorable mention All-Canadian defender. Gets three accolades, so watch for him, number 44. And he will usually be locking off against a top player from the other team. Right now, he appears to be sitting on Brandon Slade. Brock will just move things around the outside. Slade back at the X. He's going to take a pass right here from Kyle Davis. Davis was the leading scorer in Kufla this year with 34 goals and 28 assists for 62 points. Sorry about that. Got a little frog in my throat there. Brock moving around, letting everybody get a touch, get things started. They'll sit Brandon Stahl down on the crease. Now he's going to slide out high as they move it around. Slade comes back out top. Gage Board, another All-Canadian. Or a honorable mention All-Canadian. Guelph actually led the West Division with five All-Canadian selections. They also had one honorable mention. Brock, on the other hand, three All-Canadians and five honorable mentions. So plenty of accolades between these two teams. Brock finished first in the regular season. The Guelph Gryphons finished third in a very tightly packed West Division. And then the big win yesterday over Bishops, and what a game they had. There you see Van Galen putting some pressure on Brandon Slade. Brock still moving the ball around. Really a feeling out process so far this first minute and three quarters. Travis Arch trying to make a little headway. Gives it over to Stahl. And you can see the Brock in their red uniforms, looking very similar to the McGill colors with the red and white. Guelph in the black with the red numbers on the jerseys. Stahl trying to work his way out. Very close to the crease, and he did step in it. I thought his feet were right on top of the line. We have a possession call. The ball is going to go over to the Guelph Gryphons.
Yeah, and like you said, we have so many guys you want to watch there on that Brock team. You got Kyle Davis, Brandon Slade, Greg Davidson, all guys that have scored at least 45 points or more this season. A lot of that coming on the power play, actually, and all three of those guys with shorthanded markers as well.
Greg Davidson with 38 goals to lead Kufla. What a season for him. 38 goals in just 11 games. Kyle Davis with 34 goals, 28 assists, as we mentioned, so he can do it on both sides of the equation. There's Curtis Knight, who's the player of the game yesterday, a standout player with the Edmonton Rush of the National Lacrosse League, a one-time Minto Cup MVP with the Whippy Warriors, and a two-time Minto champion, leading them just this past summer to another championship. There's a shot and a goal, the opener of the game, scored on the run by Guelph. Brett Ulbikas, on his offside, crosses over to the far side of the net and buries one past Ian Duffy. And Guelph is off to a hot start. I love some things that Ben Van Galen was saying after the game yesterday. He was saying how they felt like they'd really let a lot of little things get them off their game earlier. He was talking about if they had a long bus ride, if they didn't get the toppings they wanted on their pizza, little things would really get them off their game, and they allowed it to happen as Van Galen knocks that face-off ahead, but taps it over his teammate and gets the win as it goes to Brandon Pitts. And he was saying they've really worked on that, on dealing with adversity, on not letting things get them off their game. And it worked yesterday. We'll see if they can manage to pull out a win here today against Brock. Ball goes over to the far side. Guelph, who scored quickly on that Obika shot, hasn't even really gone through the feeling out process yet, and they're going to go through a bit of it now. Connor Duchars moves the ball around, goes to Obika and back over to the far side.
Now, this is a lot like what we saw in the first two quarters of the McGill-Queens game. You want to spread out that defense, and as you can see, the players, especially at that X position, way back towards the goal line, trying to feel out this defense and get men open down up into the middle. And there's a shot.
Ryan Serville, who yesterday scored five goals, three of them on spin moves. That time he just came out from behind and took that little plant and spin towards the net. So he is very dangerous. A big body. There he almost gets the quick pass from Jordan Critch behind. Critch leading Kufalu in assists with 34 this season. And he showed you why, as he almost set up Serville for the goal. Keep your eye also on Curtis Knight. Of course, he's not out there right now. One thing you'll notice a lot, Knight will play on his offside. And there's Brett Obikas, who spends a lot of time on the offside as well, a lefty over on the left side of the field. A little unusual, but they do set that up a lot with Curtis Knight coming over onto the offside. This time, it is Calvin Holland, number 13, playing on his offside. So they like to get a bit of a mix up there, switch things up a little bit. Connor Duchars with the ball. He's going to go back to Obikas, and there he goes over to Calvin Holland, who's going to try and drive towards the net. Goes back to Critch in behind the net. Critch playing for the Buffalo Bandits of the National Lacrosse League, but he is stripped by Robert King. Nice little flip behind the back pass there by Brendan Vogan to help the clear for the Badgers.
And obviously playing on your offside, it allows you to cut through the middle quickly and get shots off, especially when your stick is close to the middle of the field, so... Look for those inside quick passes and quick shots through the middle.
McGill setting up. They get the ball back over to Kyle Davis. He's going to come out top to Jordan Costa. Oh, sorry, that's to Nick Ribka. Again, Brock just feeling their way around. They haven't really made much of a head towards the net yet, but here's the first chance. Oh, what a goal. Dropping low, shooting high. Mark DeBrone, the all-Canadian D-Mitty, but shows he's got some chops at the offensive end of the field as well.
Yeah, what a shot there. Just going right down low and putting it over top of the goaltender there. Great individual effort.
Mark DeBrone, just as we were saying that nobody had gone to the net, he drives, sees that open lane, and cuts in. And we have a 1-1 game about 6.5 minutes in here. And I expect to see plenty more of that. There's so much firepower on both sides of the field here.
And interesting enough, a lot of penalties on both sides here. You look at a guy like Ben Van Galen, you know, 20 minutes in penalties this season. So look for a lot of box time for some of these players.
There's a pass that gets up over the top, over the stick of Justin Pitchell. Pitchell, another all-Canadian for the Badgers in the defensive zone. You can see when you look at the list of their all-Canadians and honorable mentions, it's really slanted for both these teams on the offensive side. Pitchell, the only real defender for the Pitchell is the only defender for the Badgers who's in there. Kyle Kropman, more of a defensive player, but he's on as face-off specialist. And David Nedelko, along with Van Galen, defensively for the Guelph Gryphons, but the rest of the all-Canadians really up in the offensive zone, except Ian Duffy, the Brock goaltender, is an honorable mention all-Canadian as well. There's a shot taken from the high slot by Taylor Brown, but he had a defender all over him. Quinn Stewart not letting him get much on it. And it looks like the ball is going to slip out the back of the zone. It's going to be Brock possession. Here comes Matt Fountain, taking his time, passes it up. Long pole to long pole as Quinn Stewart moves the ball up. Kyle Davis trying to cut to the net. He's going to come out, shoot, just misses. Managed to slide by Nedelko. We're going to have him in the crease. It's going to be Guelph possession.
Good speed there to the outside as he cuts towards the middle and tries to get a shot off.
That's something you see from both of these teams a lot of as they try and drive towards the net. Here comes Guelph with a quick clear.
And, you know, we talked about it earlier as well. We expect a high-scoring affair today with so many all-Canadians up front for both sides. You know, will the defense be exposed?
There's Curtis Knight, number 9, just carried the ball up, gives it off to Connor Duchars. Watch for Knight as he cuts to the slot. not quite ready to make the pass to him as he came open, but he will get himself open, and he is also an excellent setup, man. And he plays very well in the defensive zone. He's a terrific all-around player. Was our game MVP yesterday. There he takes the shovel pass. He's going to slow things down, pass it back up top to Ulbikas. Goes over to Duchars. There's Knight cutting. That's a couple of times he's cut in and had a step on the defender. Nice recovery by Jonathan Corkery before Guelph was able to get the ball to him. But if they can be ready to pass when he's cutting through, if they can get the timing together, that's going to be dangerous and create some opportunities. Here comes Duchars with the shot.
I think that went off a stick there and out, but first the ball is Guelph, so they'll maintain possession here.
Jordan Critch slowly working his way out. Starts to speed up a little. He's got Justin Pitchell on him. Pitchell, who was selected. There's a nice save. Ian Duffy going down low to stop that one. That ball comes out of the scrum into Duffy. And it's going to be Brock possession. Justin Pitchell was a draft pick this year in the National Lacrosse League draft. So a lot of these guys have some serious indoor talent as well. Pitchell smartly not making the pass over to Mark DeBrone, who was covered by Curtis Knight. And Knight is a dangerous guy to be messing around with the ball with, because he will put it in the net very quickly if he has a chance to steal it. So they go back to Duffy. He's going to run it up and try for the clear. Get some help from Greg Davidson coming all the way back into the defensive zone. Well, for the fairly aggressive ride here, as they're really pressuring, have a couple of guys coming up pressuring the ball carrier. And Brock able to clear it. They've got the long pole going towards the net. Pitchell with the pass over almost gets it to Davis.
He was looking backdoor to Davis all the way there, yeah. And Davis just couldn't manage to get his stick on it.
Just a little bit away from the stick, and Pitchell heads back to his own zone. That would have been a dandy of a play.
If you're going inside, you're looking for Greg Davidson or Kyle Davis, both guys 34 and 38 goals on the season. And as we mentioned earlier, power play specialists.
Of course, Brandon Slade playing at the X for the most part. There's a high pass that goes over the top above Jordan Critch and is lost. But Brandon Slade, not too bad either with 28 goals. To have three guys with 28 or more goals is really pretty remarkable. Nice slow clear here for the Badgers. He's going to go back. Fountain throws it back over to Duffy. Taking the time. Of course, there's no timed clear in Kufla, so you've got as long as you need to move the ball out. Usually not really an issue. It seems like they are pretty... The players want to get the ball up the field and get playing. A little pressure from Serville on Duffy forces the long pass across the field, but it's completed no problem, and Brock gets it up over center. Pitchell once again up into the offensive zone. Ball comes to the near side to Mitch Robertson. Over to DeBrone. Brock getting things established. Not a lot of substituting. Both these teams tend to have a lot of guys who play both ways. They'll just, the midfielders will get the ball, move it up, and stay out there for the offense. And they'll go more in shifts, more look at it like when you need a bit of a break, switch them up and let the guys play.
And the benches seem a lot shorter in the East as well. I mean, we talked about McGill during their game, how many players are on that roster, and a good save there.
Really nice save as the cutter across the middle got a good shot off.
And then you look at the two rosters for the Guelph Gryphons and the Brock Badgers, you know, shorter benches out there. So a lot of guys are playing top minutes, and, you know, does that affect them in the long run? Are they getting tired out there and, you know, their legs getting a little weak? Yeah, probably, but you're putting your best product out there, or at least you're trying to. So skilled guys up front for most of the game, and it's always dangerous that way.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how that plays out. One of these teams will be facing the McGill Redmen tomorrow. I believe the start time's 12:30. We'll have to double check on that. That one goes off the side of the net, and Duffy comes up with it. Duchars trying to come out from behind and tuck one in. There's the pass out to Fountain, who's played a big role so far in the game for the Badgers.
Good communication on the back end, though, for these Brock players, as the defense really know where each other are. They can feel where the play's going, and they're looking for that open man up top. So they have no problem taking their time in the defensive zone trying to set things up.
There's the long lob pass back over to Fountain from Duffy. And once again, Brock successful. they have that patience, and then as soon as something comes open, they make the long pass or make the or the short pass, the correct pass, I guess, is the most important thing. Travis Arch with the ball. He's looking to Slade in behind the net. Slade, a rookie this year. What a first season to start off with. Slowly moving the ball around the outside. Gage board. Moves it in behind. There's Slade once again. He's going to come back over to Arch. Now Brock sliding a couple players down onto the crease. There's Stahl tracking behind the net. Followed by Garrett Daly. There's a shot. Didn't get a whole line on that one. Snyder will take his time now behind the net. Slowly coming out past his crease. Brock's getting some changes while they're riding. Snyder still hanging on to it. Gives it over to Ben Van Galen. Van Galen with a fantastic game yesterday. Going up high to catch that one. Nice job by Obikas. Now he's going to drive towards the slot. Nice pass. Quick movement and just gets away from Serville. Critch had Serville set up and it just skipped out of his stick. Looked like his eyes were a little big. He was trying to shoot before he'd caught it. And here comes Brock the other way.
Well, there's a hit up top.
There's another hit, and then a hit on the man down on the ground. No call as it's away from the play. They just let it keep going. This, you're talking at last game, not getting particularly physical, but this one already, we see the physical side play ramping up. We're 4 minutes away from the end of the first quarter.
And it's those loose ball hits that might get you in trouble later in the game or, you know, when emotions are high and you take a bad penalty here or there, and especially it's a 1-1 game here. Things are tight. And you can see Sam Kozakowski, the head coach there, the Guelph Gryphons, he's been very animated on the bench trying to get his players into it and making sure that they're keeping discipline out there.
Yeah, you wonder how, teams often talk about how they don't necessarily like the situation Brock and McGill find themselves in, having some time off, not playing a quarter, not playing a play-in game for the playoffs. Basically, the first round of the playoffs was held last weekend, and all the other teams except for Brock and McGill had to play there, and it can be a little tough for a team like Brock to come in and be sharp. Meanwhile, Guelph has been playing a lot, and they had a big emotional win yesterday, and you wonder how they are emotionally coming in, and I think we're seeing a bit of that on both sides today.
Yeah, well, McGill not looking rusty at all in the match earlier today, winning pretty handily, and Connor Goodwin a big part of that win.
Great strip. Here comes the pass out on top. The shot just a little bit wide by Greg Davidson. Nice job by Brandon Stahl to create that turnover.
Yeah, good movement there by Brock as they're trying to find the open man, and he just slid down there into that 20-yard box area and try to rip a shot just wide of the net, though.
They come back up top. They'll set things up with Travis Arch with the ball. They've actually got Brandon Stahl set up back behind the net now. Van Galen staying back and covering him. Brandon Slade has gone over to goal line extended. We'll see if they switch over or if they try something different for a while. Actually, sorry, that was Greg Davidson over there, and Slade actually taking a bit of a break. Arch goes back up top with the ball. Here comes Board. Goes over to Arch. He has to cross over to take the pass on his offside. That pass is thrown away. Oh, and it pops right out of the stick of Matthew Lyons. Oh, and it results directly in a goal. Ball pops over to Brandon Stahl, and he buries that one. The bounce shot past Jeremy Snyder. Brandon Stahl making it 2-1 in favor of the Brock Badgers. So that was Brandon Stahl with the goal and the assist going to Gage Board. Two to one in favor of Brock.
So Brock putting the pressure on early here. We like the movement we see out of their offense so far.
Oh, Here, Guelph setting up now. Jordan Critch behind the net. Going right-handed for a bit. Switches back to his normal left hand. Up top to Taylor Brown. Curtis Knight moves it quickly over to Ulbikas. Full circuit of the field by this Guelph offense. Now they start to slide somebody in. There's the cut to the middle. Ball pops loose. Everyone battling for it. Curtis Knight tries to get there. Matt Fountain once again. What a solid start to the game for him.
Yeah, what a play there with his stick as he kind of maneuvered it on the ground around the Guelph player and then got it to his own stick. So great way to get in the defensive end of things and kind of set up an offensive play there.
But Mark DeBrone throws it past Greg Davidson. And the ball will be turned back over to Guelph.
Guelph's doing a good job setting up this sort of, it's almost like a pentagon, how wide they're getting in the offensive zone. And it's really opening up opportunities through the middle. And we saw that last game, and it's an effective way to kind of open up guys down low and get those quick shots off. And
that will be the end of the first quarter. The Brock Badgers leading 2-1 over the Guelph Gryphons. And not exactly the explosive offensive affair we're expecting, but they're feeling it. You can see things starting to come, some chances. And so far, both clubs having some opportunities, and you can just see the stage being set for more coming.
Yeah, and the trouble is, especially with weather like this, it's extremely cold outside. You know, you can feel the temperature even dropping up here in the booth as the heat's not going full blast. So we're getting a little chilly, got the mittens on and the coats and whatnot. But you can tell down there on the field as well, your legs cramp up a little easier. You got to get the fluids running through the body, and you got to get heated up on that bench, especially if you haven't been playing in the first or second quarter. Come third and fourth quarter time, you want your players fresh. And you know, even guys that haven't been in the game, haven't been sweating it out, they're still going to be rusty. Their legs are going to be cramped up, and you got to get that blood flowing. So obviously the weather affecting games, and it's all a part of the nature of outdoor lacrosse.
Yeah, you know, the championship's always going to be at the end of the season, obviously, and that takes us into the beginning of November. You know, it's not bad weather for the beginning of November. A little bit colder than usual, down around 4 degrees, 5 degrees today, and probably slip down below that now. So we can certainly see our breath up here in the broadcast booth. Yesterday, of course, with the huge wind that we had, we saw leaves flying around. It was actually difficult to tell at times whether it was yellow leaves flying about or flags that the officials were throwing. There are a couple of officials' flags out on the field, which means probably they're coming from stick checks because the refs are heading over to the scorer's table. And when we get back underway, we'll find out what that came from.
And, of course, here at Molson Stadium and part of McGill Athletics, we always like to give a big shout-out to all of our sponsors here who support us game in and game out. That's Molson Export, Via Rail Canada, Napa Auto Parts, TELUS, GMC, Unipri, CN, and BMO. So we obviously love to an extent. And they have offered so many great things. The Player of the Week gets discounts at, I believe, Ye Olde Orchard has a special here for the student-athletes for McGill. So obviously we love going down there and getting a bite to eat at the local pub.
Nice.
But great support here for the teams and all of McGill Athletics.
I traveled up here from Peterborough for to cover the weekend. Took the train, came up on Via Rail, a very pleasant way to travel.
It's great. It's quick. It's affordable, and the food's actually quite good.
And you don't have to drive. I mean, it's nice to be able. I was able to do some work on the way up, and it works out fairly well. You know, in terms of stress-free way to get across the part of the country.
Absolutely.
Here we come back out. Haven't heard any indication yet if those flags were for stick players whose sticks were checked during the break. Nobody so far has made their way over to the penalty box areas, to the penalty chairs. Looks like a full complement of 9 runners for each team. Actually, Guelph only has 8 runners out on the field, and now they're switching somebody over, but nobody's in the penalty area. Hopefully we'll get an announcement of that soon as Van Galen lines up for the face-off against Kropman. And this time it's Guelph coming up with the ball. Garrett Daly Has it. We'll just pass it off and head for the bench. There's Connor Ducharge with the ball. And it is. It does look like we're 5-on-5 here. Okay, so one of the McGill players went off. There is now a player from each team in the penalty box area. So we are 5-on-5 lacrosse at the moment. Obikas with the pass. They go behind the net to Critch. It's Ryan Serville for Guelph. And Jake Nyhus for McGill serving the penalties. So Serville, one of the big scorers for Guelph, having some... having to sit down for the illegal stick. There's Critch behind the net. Passes it out. It's knocked down by Justin Pitchell. Pitchell can't corral the ball. It's still free on the ground.
And Jordan Critch so fast with his feet. He's a speedy guy down low, and he just gets in and out of his cuts so quickly.
Yeah. You can see him getting after that loose ball, but Brock did eventually come up with it, and they will have Ian Duffy clearing. He's going to stop just past the 30-yard line right on the Molson Export sign. Wait for his cohort to come and join him.
You love the communication you're seeing here from Brock, though. The players are actively talking down on the field, waving, you know, balls to be played up to certain players who are open, and that's what you want. You want your guys communicating. Obviously, the coach pretty loud on the bench, but if you got your guys all on the same page, just the whole strategy, the whole game plan just moves so much smoother.
And here they come with some speed now, carrying the ball forward. There's the pass off and the shot. Good save by Jeremy Snyder on the shot by Davidson. Dangerous scorer, and he has stopped once again. Snyder having a very strong game so far. Snyder will slowly bring it out for the clear. Now he's going to lob it over to the far side.
Good positional save by Snyder, like you said, deep in his net, but paddle out right in the middle and came up with a big save there.
Van Galen handles that one off the hop, just bounces out of his stick for a moment, but he gets it back. He's watched by Brandon Slade. We'll throw the long pole pass well across the field. That's Matthew Lyons running the ball up. Now he'll head back onto his own side of things. We'll see if Guelph's able to operate effectively down there without Ryan Serville. Right now, it's Michael Cavanaugh carrying the ball. He'll throw it up top. Curtis Knight has a look around, then drives past his man, pass off, and just doesn't quite connect. On the wrong side for Obikas to catch. Bit of a uncharacteristic pass there by Curtis Knight, not hitting the man in the right spot. It's funny with players who are that good, when they make a mistake like that, it seems to stand out so much. Because, I mean, Curtis Knight is such a brilliant lacrosse player. When he makes an error, it just seems almost shocking. There's a nice shot and another save by Jeremy Snyder.
I don't think Snyder knew where it was there for a minute. It was stuck between his leg and his arm, but a good save there, getting down in the almost like a butterfly position.
You could tell he felt it because he just stayed still, not letting the ball drop out. He knew he had a feel where it was. He just wasn't too sure. Wanted to make sure it didn't squeak away. Here's Serville back on the field now as we are over 3 minutes into the second quarter. So the penalized players are back. There's one knocked down. Brock coming back the other way. They've got some numbers. See if they can take advantage here. We're 5-on-5 now, actually. There's the pass down. That was Quinn Stewart picking that pass off and running it up the field. That ball is knocked free, losing his stick. Was Kyle Davis. It's going to be Guelph possession.
And the weather, as we mentioned earlier, obviously affecting the game, but it also affects the ball too. And the ball gets a lot harder in these conditions, and that's coming at you, especially as a goaltender with a lot of velocity. So give these guys a lot of credit for standing behind some of the hardest shot takers in the Kufla League.
I always give goalies a lot of credit and a fair amount of disbelief that they actually do stand in there and face the shots that they do. The thing that is so amazing is how good they are with their sticks. And there's a shot, gets awry, goes into the back as a pass. Coming out now, and the goal by Ryan Serville. He's been out for just under 2 minutes after serving his 3-minute stick penalty. Gets his stick legal and uses it to tie the game up for Guelph.
There you go. You got the leading scorer for Guelph, Ryan Serville. 34 goals, as we mentioned, 18 assists with 2 power play goals and 2 shorties on the season with only 5 penalty minutes. And he's obviously making things happen here in the second quarter. It is 2-2 with 14:54 left.
Kroppen and Van Galen will line up once again for the faceoff. And I'll tell you, this is for a 2-2 game, there have been a lot of opportunities. Both goalies with some big saves. Snyder in particular has been particularly really sharp. And
and the offense really coming through here. And we knew that this was going to be a high-octane offense for both sides. But the McGill-Queens game, big defensive standouts. Mm-hmm. We mentioned Braden Nix on the back end there. Quentin Bradley as well.
So many of the Queens players had strong games. Nate Kirstens was very good. But it does seem to be tilted a bit more on the offensive side here, even though the scoring isn't huge. I mean, we actually haven't had a ton of goals, just at 2-2 here, 6 minutes into the second quarter. So we've got to give some credit to the defense as well. Comes over to Kuchars. Connor Duchars. Rolls it way around. There's Ulbeckis on the offside. Passes it back. Guelph getting the ball moving around quickly around the exterior. Not able to penetrate so far. It seems to be a noticeable difference when Curtis Knight is not on the field in terms of how effective the Guelph Gryphons are at getting the ball to the interior areas.
Well, you look at what they're doing now, and it is effective the way they're passing the ball. They're only curdling it once or twice and then getting the pass off, and a good save there.
That was Serville again coming from behind the net, coming out past the goal line extended. Serville likes to set up in that spot, similar to Brendan Zona we saw for Queens last game, set up near the crease on the goal line extended. But he's really, in the last couple of days, also been starting behind the net and working his way out front and getting some terrific shots off. A nice save there that time, though, by Ian Duffy. Duffy makes the pass now. Twilight descending on us here. It is at 5:02 p.m. and we are Eastern time, and we're seeing things, definitely some dusk coming on us. Of course, the clocks will go back tonight. We'll get an extra hour of sleep, but that means it'll get dark that much earlier.
Yeah, exactly. And you look at the, you know, obviously the D-men on either side. A lot of standing around in lacrosse as well for the defensive players when the play is obviously in the other end of the field. And, you know, will the temperature affect them and their game? And we'll have to wait till the third and fourth quarter to see those effects take place or not.
Ball comes out high for the Brock Badgers. Stahl has it. Gets it over on the far side to Mitch Robertson. Mitch Robertson playing with the Markham Ironheads in Junior B, a Whippy native. Comes back over to Greg Davidson. Brock having a little conversation among a few of their forwards, their attack players, having a little chat on top of the crease about what they want to try and run here. They've got Stahl and Davis setting up on the crease as they work it around, just waiting for an opportunity to probe in. There's Robertson again on the far side.
Nice pick there by David Nedelko, as he frees up his man on the inside, and it translates into a nice goal. Connor Duchars.
Duchars buries it again. That was actually Brandon Stahl throwing that pick, opening him up. And Duchars buries that one, puts Brock back in front. Mitch Robertson taking the assist on the Duchars goal. And you can just see Brock working their way, trying to create the opportunities and eventually getting that chance in tight. So tricky when you get that congestion in front of the crease here. Guelph takes the ball on the possession foul, transgression. Curtis Knight hits the cutter. There's the pass, the shot off the far post. What a chance for Taylor Brown. He recovers the ground ball, throws it back up top to Knight. Knight's going to try and get things going. Nobody at all in the middle for Guelph. Now Taylor Brown slides in there as Knight trots across to the offside. He's being shadowed by John Fitzgerald. We've got a call over on the far side. We have an offside call against Guelph. I believe it was offside. It's going to be a turnover in Brock possession. you can ill afford errors like that. I'm not sure exactly. We weren't watching. It was kind of behind the play. But possession can be so valuable in this game. There's Knight tracking after the player in the defensive zone. That's the one reason Knight will come out sometimes in the offensive end as a two-way midi. You will see him playing a lot of defense very effectively at both ends as well.
And you like what Ryan Serville's doing. He kind of goes down low, then comes back up top. He's almost sharking his way among the defense, just trying to find an open seam.
Here comes McGill, or Brock moving the ball back. Comes up top to Brandon Slade. Slade moves it over. They hand it off. Gage Board has given it to Greg Davidson. Davidson trying to see where he can find a way to get in. He's going to pass it back up top to Slade. There's Slade moving all over the place. We do see Slade, as you mentioned, spending a lot of time down in behind the goal. And he's come well up to the top, up around the 40-yard line at this point. Pass goes over to Brandon Stahl. Stahl's going to try and drive out in front of the net. He's watched well by Garrett Daly. That ball almost gets away, but it's tracked down by Davis. He's going to get back over to Board. Board being watched by Curtis Knight. Reverses field. In behind to Stahl. Brandon Stahl having a very strong game so far. Once again, Daly on him. Daly turns him back the other way. Stahl comes out, shoots, just misses on the far side. Ball picked up by Christian LeBlanc. LeBlanc looked at first like he was just going to shield and let that ball go out. It didn't have enough momentum, though, so he had to go and pick it up. Did a nice job of getting it back to his partner. And now Curtis Knight clearing the ball over center.
Yeah, and you look at this team. I mean, you got so many players in double figures for goals. And you know that means that they're really taking their time passing that ball around, getting their possession game open, and looking for high percentage shots.
That's what they're going to do here. Again, nobody in the middle for Guelph. They'll take their time moving around the outside. Duchard's going over to Taylor Brown. Still nobody down in the slot. Guelph taking some time. We're coming up on the 7-minute mark of the second quarter. Knight has it back. They get it to Obikas. Obikas trying to drive down the middle. He makes it. Shoots, scores. What a play. Obikas with his second of the game.
What a great individual effort there. Cutting through the middle and finishing up top. That's a goal scorer's goal right there.
Just such great footwork. Just taking the exact perfect angles to get through the slim openings that he had.
And we talked about that speed up front, and Guelph has got a lot of it. And especially when you look at these point totals, you can tell why they're so successful. When you got speed and you can burn defenders like that, cutting into the middle, even whether or not you're playing on your offside, you're getting into open space and you're taking high percentage shots like that. Obviously, the ball is going to go in more times than not.
Again, we have an infraction on the faceoff, and Ben Van Gale will take the ball. He's going to go up and join the offense for a while. Looked like he wanted to shoot there. He gets it off instead to Calvin Holland. Holland loses the ball. It gets down onto the turf.
A bit of a hit to the head there, but I'm not sure what the referee is calling here on the play as the flag is down.
Yeah, it's going to be a penalty to Brock. So give Guelph possession back and the man advantage. Mark DeBrone with a 30-second penalty for the illegal push. Serville up a little high, up around the 30-yard line. A little bit of a different look. Curtis Knight passes it off to Obikas. He goes to the far side to Critch. Goes down low.
Like you said, watch for Curtis Knight. He has 7 power play goals on the season. And he loves to kind of swing in from up top and let one go.
Got it from Duchard's down to Knight there. At the goal line, he works his way out. Nice job by Quinn Stewart, staying with him. Duchars gives it to Serville. He tried to get it to a cutting Obikas. That one's knocked down, though, by Ian Duffy. That'll do it for the penalty, so we're back to even strength. Just under 5 minutes to go here in the second quarter.
Tight game here at 3-3.
Ball comes back up top to Arch. He's going to give it up to Brandon Slade. Slade will head down behind the goal line. He's got Davis with him back there, and he's going to pass it now to Davis. Quick closing, Christian LeBlanc forces him out wide. They move it back around the top. Mark DeBrone up there with for Brock on the offense. He's just sliding out in the high slot now as Slade passes over to Davis. DeBrone heading towards the crease. They're going to continue to move it around the outside for now, and it's going to be Davis sliding into the crease area. Travis Arch trying to find some space. Covered well by Nedelko.
Good job by Arch, though. He's not forcing anything. He realizes defender's right with him, and he makes the quick pass off. He'd rather keep possession and try something else than try a high-risk play like that in a tight game, 3-3.
Here comes a drive. The pass over to Slade. Can't quite connect. It's picked up by Van Galen. Gets it over to the goaltender. The goaltender's going to fall out of bounds. Great hustle by DeBrome, but he's going to get a penalty instead. He thought he'd forced a turnover. Instead, he's going to take a penalty. I was going to say, you know, to your point, the one thing we're seeing in this game on both sides is both offenses being very patient, but moving the ball, nobody hanging on to the ball too long. You talked at one point in the last game about Kevin Donovan, you know, maybe he held the ball a bit too long a couple times, and very good player, obviously, but I don't think there's been a single time where we've had to say, you know, somebody needs to move the ball. These guys know it, and they are moving it. They get a shot there with quick movement.
Exactly. I mean, they're cradling maybe once or twice before they're letting that ball go, and it just opens up the offense so much more and spreading that defense. And we can't say enough about the way that Guelph has done that so far. And there's a goal right there as a result.
Again, with the spin move, he scored three on them yesterday. Gets another one today. What a play by Serville. And it is 4-3 for the Guelph Gryphons. I believe that's their first lead of the day. Just over 2 minutes left in the half, and the Gryphons have taken the lead. We figured this was going to be a battle right down from wire to wire, and it has been so far. Guelph with their first lead. Van Galen and Kropman line up for the faceoff.
And you know, either one of these teams would love a crack at playing McGill in the finals, and you know, with that perfect record, no one else would love to play spoiler more than either Brock or Guelph.
No question. Gage Board with the pass down. Can't quite be handled, but Davis does pick it up. Now it's loose again. Great positioning by LeBlanc as he helped his teammate Curtis Knight pick that ball up. Here comes LeBlanc up the field. Got some momentum. Now he's going to throw the long cross-field pass over to Cooper Catt.
And you haven't seen a lot of drop passes from the long poles either.
No, and they're been really
and
sharp.
And they've been very sharp in terms of possession and keeping hold of that ball and not getting too sloppy out there, making, you know, an extra deke or two. And as you mentioned earlier, you know, guys are just being smart with the ball.
Mm-hmm. Guelph takes a timeout. They're going to try and set things up with just over a minute left here in the half. They're going to probably work for this possession, one would think, trying to get a last shot off.
And how important is that momentum going into the second half of play?
I would say when a game's this close and, you know, I mean, the history, the great rivalry between these teams, I think it's very important. I mean, Guelph has really started to believe in themselves of late. Van Galen was talking, like I said earlier, about doing the little things, and little things include, you know, making smart decisions in situations like this, and momentum can play such a big role. It can also change very quickly. One thing that we've seen a lot of is stick checks during the timeouts, during the quarter and half times, resulting in penalties. So that can change things pretty quickly. But, you know, assuming there are no stick check penalties coming out of the half, then I would think another goal here, go up by two when they've just taken their first lead, would be a big boost for these Gryphons.
And obviously, team leadership is another big part of winning championships. And you, when you look at the McGill squad in particular, obviously Tim Murdoch, no discredit to him, he's done a wonderful job with that team, and he's always in the dressing room, kind of, you know, giving his two cents on what he thinks the team needs to improve on. But there's so many leaders there that speak up, and you know, will confront guys about their play or you know what they want to do on the offensive side of the ball or the defensive side, and you love that. You love that out of your guys who are willing to go that extra mile and just say, you know what, I'm going to take a leadership role here, and I'm going to try to rally the guys around me.
Yeah, you know, and for Guelph, certainly, you've got someone like Ben Van Galen, who's a pretty vocal leader. And you've got somebody like Curtis Knight, doesn't speak a whole lot. From a media perspective, he's not an ideal interview because he really doesn't like to talk. He really doesn't like to talk about himself. But the things he says are very cogent. And, you know, with that quiet approach and the on-field leadership, by example, he shows, players are listening whenever he does say something. They can't quite connect on the pass there. But they do pick it up again. Duchard switches to his left side and scores.
Shot.
That's a great shot for the right-handed Duchard, burying the left-handed shot. And they didn't I think there's still some time. We don't see the clock carrier on the field, so there's still over 30 seconds. So they didn't use the whole time for last shot. But when you can get that goal and go up 5-3, that's a big one. Now we'll see who gets possession off the faceoff.
Yeah, and coming in off his offside on the left there and making it easier, coming through the middle and you know, his sticks right there on the right side with where he can just rip the shot and just, you know, hope going upstairs where goal scorer is going. And just like that, 5-3.
Nice play by Van Galen to flip that ball out to Curtis Knight, who comes up with it, goes down, comes up, then the ball is knocked out of his stick. The play is whistled down. I believe that's going to be halftime. Everyone kind of gradually making their way over to the sidelines. Oh, it's a Guelph timeout. So that's a very sharp timeout call to get the timeout before they lose possession. They will retain the ball. With just a few seconds to go here, the clock is now on the field, so we're into the final 30 seconds. And what a momentum booster it would be for Guelph if they could get another goal and go up 6-3.
Yeah, absolutely. Brock's looking for a big stop here and you know, try to bring some sort of, you know, maybe shift the momentum in their favor and, you know, come up with maybe a late goal or a big hit. And like we said in last game, it doesn't really matter whether we've seen it, you know, in hockey all the time, a big hit leading to a big play or, you know, taking the body, whatever it may be, to just get that extra edge, that extra kind of spice to your team. And that usually results in a lot of success down the road in the game.
Curtis Knight will start with the ball up about midfield. The clock carrier is right out beside the referee to let him know how the time is going. Play about to be whistled in. There we go. We're underway. Knight bringing the ball down. He's going to make a quick pass down to Serville. That's going to miss. And Brock will actually get possession. They had to try the quick pass because obviously there wasn't much time as the whistle goes for halftime.
Yeah, they didn't have a choice there. But you know what? We do see some, I believe those are some McGill lacrosse players in the crowd coming out to kind of scout this one out to see who they'll potentially be facing tomorrow afternoon for the championship game. But, you know, Tim Murdoch obviously stressing to his players, get out there, get familiarized with some of these players in the East that you don't see that often because it's going to be a bit of a challenge tomorrow.
I am Stephen Stamp with Mark Amendiola, and we will be back after the halftime festivities. So stick around. Go get what you need to get done because it's going to be a great second half here on the Sports Streaming Network. Thanks for being with us. We'll see you shortly. Hello, lacrosse friends. Welcome back to the Bagataway Cup semifinals. It is 5-3 in favor of the Guelph Gryphons, a pair of late Gryphons goals giving them the edge. I'm Stephen Stamp with Mark Amendiola. And Mark, what a it was a very solid feeling out kind of first half. We expected maybe a little more explosiveness with the scoring, but this is a pretty solid, tight game.
Yeah, it's definitely really tight, and we talked a lot about the possession game that the Guelph Gryphons are playing. Quick passes to the outside, but they're not making kind of forced plays. They're not forcing anything on the inside. It's all coming with opening their men up, and they're working the pick and roll as well, and that's been pretty effective.
Van Galen and Kropman in there for the faceoff. Kropman's going to come out with this one. Kropman wins it himself, gets it back from John Fitzgerald. Now Fitzgerald will head off, and Kropman's going to stay out there while they get things established. Now Brock getting their offensive personnel on the field. Brandon Stahl will take the ball from Mark DeBrone. DeBrone's going to head off. So Brock slowly getting all their personnel that they want out there. Kyle Davis back to Slade. Slade over on the far side. And it's definitely cooling off. We talked about the effect of the cold weather on these players. And I mean, we're feeling it. Now, they're moving and playing, but still, you're down there, and it can be pretty cool, and it can be challenging.
Yeah, especially for the goaltender who's spending a lot of the game just on his 2 feet, not moving around too much. And you wonder whether or not that'll have an effect on them as the game goes on.
Excellent point. Gage Ward gets it over to Greg Davidson. Travis Arch with the ball out high. Brock so far not making any forays into the interior. Now Arch starts to head in towards the crease area. Here comes Stahl. He's going to pass it off to Slade, to Davis. Davis back up to Stahl. He looked like he wants to let one rip. He does. That one's saved by Jeremy Snyder. Or did it go off the crossbar? And it gets out of bounds just before midfield.
That was just an excellent strategy there that Brock was kind of running, or play rather, as three attackmen just kind of moved to the left, bringing their defender with them, kind of opened up the middle a little bit, giving the player a little bit of space to take his shot. And that's just a well-designed play. That's something that obviously you want to run as much as possible, kind of clear the middle and make way for your attackman to come inside and rip a shot home.
And obviously that one did go off the crossbar and not off the goaltender, because it is Guelph ball. Curtis Knight starts out with it. They'll try and extend their lead to 3 goals. Thrown back up top to Knight. He's going to move it over to Ubikas. Ubikas to Serville. Serville again playing up. Oh no, Serville's down low. That is Duchars over on the far side. There's a shot by Knight and stopped by Ian Duffy, who's having a great game for Brock. Maybe their best player so far.
Yeah, good save there with the stick, and very Riley McGillis-esque, if you will. Very positionally sound, and obviously coming out just a little bit to cut down that angle, but he's more of a stay-at-home kind of guy.
Yeah, I was chatting with one of the, that's a good point, I was chatting with one of the observers of the game up here in the halftime, and they were pointing out, he's stopping everything that's shot at him up high, that Guelph might want to start bouncing the ball a little bit more when they, if they're going to go shoot from a little bit farther out.
And we saw how effective that was last game.
Mm-hmm. The field, as you mentioned earlier, the field probably has dried out now. It hasn't been raining for the last couple of hours. And there was a bit of a stretch of the wind up a little bit, so that can help dry things out. Certainly, everyone seems to have good footing this game, so the elements in terms of wind and wetness, not playing a role in this game. Curtis Knight takes that pass. It was just over the extended arm of the Brock player. There's Duchars. Nice awareness of the player coming in from the bench. Turns and rips one a little bit wide, and there he was going down low. It'll be set up with Critch in the back. He gets it out to his teammate, gets it back. Taylor Brown that he's playing catch with. Now Critch is rolled out high. Critch, of course, a 2- or 3-time Minto Cup champion with the Orangeville Northmen. What a program they've produced.
And we were talking earlier about all the great lacrosse products coming out of that region.
There's a shot just a little bit wide by Curtis Knight. He had 4 goals and assists last night. Hasn't been able to get on the board today. That's a real testament to how well the Brock defense is playing. You're talking in the halftime about you like the team approach that Brock takes to defense. Nobody necessarily standing out. A nice play there by Justin Pitchell getting the ball off to Matt Goetz. But The team approach to their defense, very successful.
Yeah, all about communication. And if you're going to go off, you're a guy to kind of pick up a double team or whatever. Everybody's communicating. They know where their players are out there. And that's all about team defense there. Know where the guys that you need to pick up. And if you got to kind of roll off and take someone else's man, you make sure someone's picking him up on the back check.
Matt Fountain, who's had a strong game, carries the ball up over center, looking for somebody to pass to. Loses the ball, has it stripped, but his teammate Travis Arch is going to pick it up. Fenton will head back to his side of the field. Arch taking his time to get things rolling. No subs for Brock, so they're going to go ahead and push the pace, push the ball up into the attacking area. Take it behind the net. Davis will take the pass from Slade. He's going to come back up to Arch. Now Davis starts to head towards the interior, but sees that Gage Bourg is already there, so he'll just hold on a second. We really haven't seen Brock using any of the approaches some of the other teams we've seen today with sort of stacking players in the middle and try and create some space when they separate and try to go different ways.
Yeah, it seems to be a little bit bunched there in the middle of the field, and you wonder whether or not the coach is going to try to switch things up, because Brock needs to get on their horse here as they're down 2 goals and obviously pretty close in the first, but Guelph trying to run away with things here as time goes on in the second game today.
Yeah, and here we are 6 Cup. Minutes into the third quarter and no scoring so far in this half. And it's a little bit surprising with these two really potent offenses that they haven't. But that's a testament to scouting, among other things, because these are teams that are very familiar with each other as you know, Sam Kozakowski was saying yesterday after the win, you know, they're getting ready for Brock. Their rivalry goes back to the 80s. They've been playing each other for a long time. And, of course, Brock has been a dominant team in Kufla, winning, almost 20 championships over the years of Kufla. They've been a really productive program.
And that's actually, it's funny you mentioned that, as the East, like you said, bringing home the hardware in years past, but now it just seems like the West with the Bishops and your McGill team, the power has kind of shifted in the Kufla.
It's the other way around. You mean
or pardon me, the other way around. Yes.
Yeah. The West winning so many championships in 2011, Bishops taking it, the Eastern team, and last year McGill taking it, and certainly McGill would love to make it 3 straight for the East, but one of these teams will have something to say about that tomorrow. Jordan Critch coming up from behind the net. He's going to spin and shoot, and Duffy was ready for that one.
There's no Duffy
surprise.
Again.
Yeah, what a game he's having for them. He's just going to step back, take his time. Again, Brock communicating well, gets some help from Travis Arch, who comes back, and he'll just carry the ball forward. Now makes the pass over to the pole on the far side.
And that's Duffy's game right there. He's just looking for a quick little pass out. He's going to go back in his net and hang out and let the defense kind of take it up from there.
We saw that. You talked earlier in the first game about Riley McGillis being so good at getting the ball out quickly. And here, Duffy taking his time, but as soon as there's an opening, Brock makes that pass. They carry the ball across the top. It was Nick Ripka getting a chance to play a little bit.
You know, I guess the thing I could relate it to the most is for any Leaf fans out there, kind of Jonathan Bernier and James Reimer. You got one guy who's a great puck handler, can stop a lot of pucks, and another guy who's not the greatest puck handler, but, you know, he's just as good. And there's another, you know, guys have different styles of the way they like to play, but both very effective goaltenders.
Excellent comparison. I've been a Bernier fan for a long time.
Yeah.
But that Reimer has certainly shown quite a bit for himself. What a start for his Maple Leafs career for Jonathan Bernier.
Oh, absolutely, and it's good. Glad to see that he's getting his playing time up.
Here's the ball over with Mitch Robertson on his offside. He's going to go in behind to Slade. Slade looking over to DeBrone. Brown with a bit of a drive to the net. Gets by a couple of defenders. Well, the first one, the second one, got a piece of it and didn't let that shot get towards the net. Everyone battling for the ball on the floor, on the ground, and Slade can't come up with it.
Yeah, Mark DeBrone kind of getting the feet, getting his feet chopped out from underneath him as a couple of wild sticks in the, right in front of the goaltender there, but Brock's going to maintain possession.
Yeah, we're just talking about how Brock not really getting anyone into the interior. Now they're starting to send some guys in, create some congestion, create some confusion for the defenders, and there's a pass over. It looked like it was headed to Davis. It actually flies right over him, though, and is caught by DeBrone. Mark DeBrone taking an active role in the offense here. DeBrone recently winning a President's Cup championship, a National Senior B championship with the St. Catharines Saints. Had a very good summer season in the box.
And you love that. You love how your players are playing lacrosse outside of their schools, and that and, you know, and that revs them up for the regular season. You got guys that are playing two, three seasons of lacrosse. They're keeping fresh, and obviously their skills are developing, and they're becoming better players.
Yeah, there's such a great carryover from the box to the field and vice versa. You know, the field, playing the field game can bring some skills that guys who just play in the box don't have. And coaches rave about what playing box lacrosse does for field lacrosse players, especially here in Kufla, where it is, you know, that traditional Canadian style of plenty of contact, but not being afraid of going into the middle.
Yeah.
You can see it right here as Mitch Robertson drives towards the net and gets a shot off, getting up off the ground. The whistle clearly went before that ball went in. It's waved off.
Yeah.
That's no goal.
And, you know, you make a great point there. Box lacrosse, it makes you incredibly better in tight. Mm-hmm. And that's what it is. You have, you know, shorter angles, obviously, and you're working in close. And then you come to the field lacrosse and you start playing out on the bigger fields and whatnot, and you become a better player on the inside, like you mentioned. And you can go into those tight corner areas and get your shots off. And it does make you become a better all-around lacrosse player, whether you're playing in the box or you're playing in field.
Saw a little video on Facebook recently as Ulbikas makes the pass. There's a shot by Duchars. Doesn't get anywhere, but he's going to try and scoop it back up off the ground. We're going to have a push, and it's going to be Guelph ball. As Duchars was going for the ball, he was impeded. So the interference call. But Notre Dame, Fighting Irish, playing some in the box in a very small space. It was smaller than a typical rink. And they're playing a little indoor lacrosse to work on exactly that, just try and transfer that over. They recently had the Minnesota Swarm head coach Joe Sullivan went with some of his assistant coaches and ran a clinic for Notre Dame players to work on the skills that box lacrosse can bring to the field player. And we're certainly seeing a lot of that. I mean, some of these players who are so successful on both sides. Here's Ulbikas driving on DeBrone. DeBrone, a solid defensive player. There's the pass out front. What a goal for Curtis Knight. Takes the pass from Serville. Buries it. We talked about him not finding the net. Now he's found it.
And that was a bit of a design play there. Curtis Knight was kind of just hovering along the 30-yard line, kind of shifting his defenseman away from the net, and then out of nowhere cuts towards the middle, gets a great pass from that left side around the 10-yard line and buries it home.
In the first half, he was playing over on his normal side, on the left side, you know, as a right-handed shot, and was cutting a lot to the middle, and we talked about him cutting in and not being able to get the passes. In that case, he was back on the offside and cut in, and Serville just went across the that diagonal pass, hit him perfectly, and, you know, Duffy's spinning around as the pass comes and unable to make the save.
Yeah, it's times like this we wish we had instant replay up here in the booth.
That'd be a nice one to see. Ball still scrambled after that draw. Nobody yet able to come up with it. Now Brock establishes possession. Greg Davidson coming up with it. He's going to drive to the net. He's got his defender in a quandary, and he scores. You can see that Christian LeBlanc didn't know whether to slide over to the ball carrier or leave his man unattended or not. Got kind of caught in no man's land. Great play there by Davidson to pull it back to 6-4.
And that's exactly what Brock needed there. They needed that quick goal to respond and try to get momentum shifting in their favor. Down two goals, 6:48 left here in the third quarter. Lots of time, but you never want to be down in a big game like this.
No, there are certain times where the next goal seems important. After Guelph got that one to go up 6-3 and take that three-goal lead, it just seemed like a big deal for Brock to get that next one. They did. Here comes Van Galen, winning it to himself, but can't quite come up with the ball. Now he knocks it off to the side, and Guelph will obtain possession. Garrett Daly, sorry, who's had a very strong game for the Gryphons, getting very involved in the play. Ulbikas flips it off to his teammate. Duchar spins, throws it back to Ulbikas. He has to climb the ladder a bit to make that catch. Goes off to Brown, gets Critch involved, and Ulbikas has it back. You wondered earlier about how the short benches are going to affect these teams. We'll see as they go further on. One factor, I was mentioning at the half, Tim Murdoch, the McGill coach, said he'd love to play a Guelph team that's having to play their third game in 3 days.
Yeah, and you know what makes a ton of sense? You got guys that are tired, especially, you know, these late games. It's getting cold out there. Guys need to get their sleep in and kind of rest up. And I'm sure there's bang bonnies out there. And this game's getting a little more physical than the last game that we saw. McGill, pretty disciplined, actually. Mm-hmm. You know, not too many penalties, but.
Now, before any of the Gryphons start to put Murdoch's. Oh, what a shot by Duchars again, going to the left hand. Bouncing that shot by Duffy makes it 7-4. Duchars having a very productive game here, scoring on his offhand.
Yeah, that's his second of the game, and Ducharme's cutting towards the middle, and this seems to be a common theme this afternoon. You get the open space in the middle, they're running that, and it's the off picks too, and people don't really realize that when you're watching lacrosse at home. Obviously, you're watching where the ball is, and you're watching up top where they're passing it around and stuff, but there's a lot of action going on down low, and other players are making room for each other. There's design plays where players are picking off each other and trying to get open, and just like that, you free up some space in the middle and good things happen.
Van Galen comes up with it. I was just going to finish that thought. As I was going to say, before the Gryphons start to use Murdoch's comments as poster bulletin board material, the first thing he said was, either of these teams is going to be a big test for us. These are two very good teams. And then he said, hey, if we get to play a team that's playing their third game in 3 days, that's a bit of a bonus. But he certainly was showing a lot of respect for both of these teams and didn't want to make it sound like he wasn't.
Yeah, and that's how you got to prepare for it. You know, you got to go in there thinking that it's going to be the toughest test, and that's how, you know, then you're bringing your A game. You're bringing all the tools that you need, and you're designing a strategy and a game plan that, they're ready for you, whoever it may be, whether it be Guelph or Brock. Both very different teams, though, in terms of their playing styles.
Yeah, they are quite different. Here's the ball with Slade behind the net. He's close to the crease, manages to avoid it. Several reversals, Van Galen just staying with him. That was the one right there where he thought he could get a shot. Oh, but the save by Snyder. Van Galen staying with him the whole time, but eventually he did get an opportunity. Here comes Guelph back up the other way.
We talked a lot about Duffy, but Snyder's been pretty solid as well. He's made a few big saves.
I think he may have been even better than Duffy. I mean, he's up, you know, he's only allowed the 4 goals, and he's been outstanding. And there's a great goal. Curtis Knight setting it up. And Brett Obuk is putting it home, but they're saying it's no goal. He stepped in the crease. What a big call. It's already up on the board, and it's now coming off. The scoreboard operator was with us. He thought that one was a good goal.
Hopefully that doesn't come back to bite them, later in the game. As, tight one like this, you hate to see that one end up be the game winner or something.
Now, again, it looked like we just saw the goal. We saw it go in, but we are, a couple hundred feet away from the action, whereas the official is down there about 20 feet away. So we're going to go with his judgment on that and presume he got that one right. But certainly it could have been a momentum shift or pulling that one back. Guelph looked very pleased again. And here the Badgers driving to the net. Ball knocked free. Curtis Knight tries to come up with it. We're going to have a push on the ground ball, and it's going to be Guelph possession.
Yeah, the wind seems to be picking up a little bit. I can feel a bit of a chill here up in the booth, so whether or not the players are feeling it down there on the bench and out on the field.
I would think more on the bench than out on the field, because, at least the guys who are out on the field are getting to run around. And it is going to be Brock possession. It looked like the original call was to give possession to Guelph. I'll tell you, you can't say enough about the game that Curtis Knight plays out there. Offensively, he just scored set up that last goal, but scored a couple goals ago. But the defensive game that he plays as well, very consistent and very instrumental to this team's success. Here comes Brock. There's a pass from Davidson. Now Davis. And a big hit there, riding the man right to the ground, and it's going to be a penalty.
Flags flying left, right, and center out there. And do you like the call like that, Steve?
No, I don't.
Yeah, because you come to the game for the entertainment factor as well, and you want to see hits like that. And sometimes it just slows down the game when
it's
you agree.
It's just a big, solid hit. I think the reason he landed on top of him is because the guy, he got the big hit, which to me was from the side, and then the player goes down, and and Van Galen falls on top of him. He gets the push call, which...
Just a bit of a... got to make the judgment call there, yeah.
Yeah, I like the physical game, so maybe I'm just biased.
No, I'm going to have to agree with you on that.
Great movement by the Badgers. There's the shot from the outside. They score. That was Travis Arch putting that one home. Number 77 for the Badgers buries it. And they pull within 7-5, so that power play, that penalty call was an important one. We're into the final minute here of the third quarter. The score 7-5 for the Guelph Gryphons. I'm Steven Stamp with Mark Amendiola.
And Duchars, I mean, he's been playing fairly well this game, obviously two goals. Is he your offensive catalyst for...
I think he is so far for Guelph.
For tonight's game, yeah.
I think so. And on the other side, I mean, that was Travis Arch who's been having a very nice game. I think, you know, Davidson's been very good. You know, a lot of players taking a role, but really nobody dominating offensively the way that we might have thought they would. And it's a 7-5 game, which, you know, we would have probably thought there'd be some more goals. Here comes Guelph into the final 30 seconds. The clock is on the field. A little reversal there by Calvin Holland. Now he's going to run the ball up into the zone. John Fitzgerald staying with him. Nice defense, well away from the goal area by John Fitzgerald.
Yeah, they're really spreading things out down there on the field.
Here's Ulbikas. He thinks he sees a slot. He goes in there. Fitzgerald recovers. That's a great sequence by John Fitzgerald, number 8 for the Brock Badgers.
We got a bit of an injury
down
there.
Looks like
yeah.
a knee problem. And that's going to do it for the third quarter.
Yeah, he looks like he's in some serious pain there. Might have been a knee-on-knee. And with the weather conditions the way that it is, you know these injuries are probably going to be a little more severe than they normally would be.
And that's Mark DeBrone down on the floor, and he is a big part of that Brock team on defense and offense.
A guy that actually hasn't been on the score sheet yet is Kyle Davis.
Yeah, that's a good point.
And I mean, Kyle Davis, you know,
62 points,
yeah, 34 goals and 28 assists, big part of their power play as well. You know, he takes his fair share of penalties with 11 on the season, but, you know, he is nowhere to be found yet. And obviously they're looking for him to kind of contribute and get back on the horse here in the second half of play. In the fourth quarter.
Fourth quarter, yeah. And, you know, Davis, that is, you pointed out well, 11 and a half minutes in penalties, almost the most on the team. As an offensive player, that is pretty surprising.
Yeah, absolutely.
Don't like to see this. Mark DeBrone still down on the ground. They've got him sitting up now. Certainly immediately clutched for his knee. Looks like the right leg that he was grabbing. The Guelph Gryphons, I'll tell you, if they've got to be over their thinking. They're doing the things they want to do. And if they'd been told 3 months ago, 2 months ago when the season started, hey, you can be in the Bagataway Cup semifinals with a 7-5 lead going into the fourth quarter, would you take it? In a heartbeat, obviously.
Yeah, much different from last game. It was obviously a lot of goals going in for McGill, and McGill has a tendency to rack up the points early on. They're a team that's known to score first and kind of stay with the lead, obviously with the perfect season and whatnot, but in years past as well, typically a team that likes to get up early, and when you can ride that momentum, it kind of settles your players down, it gets the confidence going, and you can really kind of run out your game plan the way it is. But when you start getting down in games, you start, you know, kind of freaking out a little bit and going off plan, players start to try to take on more of an individual role, and that's when things kind of, you know, kind of spiral. It could be a good thing, it could also be a very bad thing. So the coach probably trying to just get his players back on track here for the fourth quarter.
Yeah, I mean, we really haven't seen a whole lot of anybody going off and playing that individual game where that can happen. I mean, they've still been taking part, moving the ball around, and generally pretty effective play by both teams. And surprisingly, given the offensive power that these teams have, very good defensive games by both. That's where if Mark DeBrone is unable to continue, that's going to really hurt the Badgers. Offensively, he does contribute, but defensively is really where he's making the most impact. We're going to have a call here. We'll see if the possession is going to Brock, which it looks like it will be.
Yeah, the refs not letting anything go this game as they've been pretty on top of their calls.
Yeah, and it's going to be Brock possession. They'll start out with the ball on the stick of Brandon Stahl. slowly moving down. They've got Davis set up on top of the crease. Now he's heading down goal line extended and spreading out a little bit. Nobody in the slot area. There's Slade, throws it over to Davis. We've got a helicopter hovering near the stadium here. Wonder if they're getting some footage for the highlights.
Getting a
tonight.
Sneak preview of tonight's game, yeah.
There you go.
It's also pretty interesting, though, that they haven't ever really considered the fourth referee out there for lacrosse.
Yeah.
Because in hockey, you know, it's obviously less players on the ice, and they want to try to catch as many things as possible. And there's so much that happens in a lacrosse game.
Oh, there's a shot by Greg Davidson. Another save by Jeremy Snyder. I tell you, both goalies have been very good and certainly contenders for their team's players of the game.
Lots of room here to maneuver.
Long run by the long pole. Guelph setting things up. They're 18 and a half minutes away from a berth in the Bagataway Cup final. If they can hang on to this, I don't know if 7 goals is going to be enough. I'm sure they'd like to get at least 1 or 2 more to make sure they've got some breathing room. Curtis Knight over on his far side passes the ball over. Going to try and hit Obikas cutting through. Instead, he'll throw it over to Duchars. Back up to Knight. Knight driving down on the far side. Ball comes to Treville. We'll see if he can come out and get a shot again. Big body shoots.
Nice.
Scores.
Great goal.
With the defender right on him. But he just muscles his way through. Treville, a big body, had a big game yesterday. And another solid effort today. His second of the game.
There he is, number one in scoring for the team. 52 points. And obviously we can't say enough good things about Ryan Treville and having a big impact here so far.
That's a Guelph goal.
8-5 now, the Gryphons lead.
And is this where you know, if you're a Brock bat, like do you push the panic button a little bit here, down 3 goals?
I think you may have to start thinking about changing things up a bit and just show a bit greater sense of urgency. They can clearly score 3 goals in 17 minutes. I mean, they've done it before, but they've only got 5 so far in 63 minutes. So they're going to have to change something up. Whatever Guelph is doing is working. Whatever Brock's doing clearly is not working the way they'd like it to. Guelph's got possession as that ball rolls out of the end zone, or into the football end zone anyway.
Yeah, and you know, we obviously talked about Kyle Davis, but Brandon Slade as well.
Yeah, Brandon Slade hasn't done as much as they would like to see from him. Here comes Snyder running well up the field, gets the ball off to Knight. Knight's going to go for a bit of a run, sees some space. He's looking to draw on dish. And instead, he just shoots and scores. It's like everyone was expecting what I was, which was going to draw defenders to him and find an outlet. And he almost just stopped, realized nobody was coming to him, and fired the ball home. Just like that, it's 9-5, and that is a really important goal.
It was almost like a no-look shot, if you will, kind of passed off everyone on the field and had the almost like an open net, as I think he fooled the goaltender as well.
Mm-hmm. Curtis Knight does so much for his club. Brock having a quick gathering. Looks like we've got a timeout called by Brock.
So that's Knight's second of the game, and, you know, he's putting him in the back of the net, and he's getting into open space. But, you know, that's just a smart individual play. He sees an opening downfield, and he takes it, and he hits it home. Whether or not, you know, he had another play in mind or they were going to work it around the outside, he saw the opportunity, and he went with the high-percentage shot.
And that is his game in a nutshell. He's a very smart player in the box or on the field, takes what is available. Not in the sense that he doesn't create anything. I mean, obviously he can create some plays for everybody, but he sees what he's got in front of him and adjusts so well, so smartly to the way the defense is playing him.
And that just makes your game so much more multidimensional. I mean, a great example would be, you know, players in the NBA. You have guys that are just spot-up three-point shooters, and they can't really create their own space. And then you have more versatile players, you know, that can run the point guard position. You know, classic example in Toronto, you had Jose Calderon, who's not a guy known to create his own space, just kind of runs the plays. He can score points, but usually on open jump shot looks. And then you got a guy like Kyle Lowry who can, you know, he can drive the ball, he can cross over, he can make people, you know, look a little silly out there, and that's obviously why he ended up with the number one job in Toronto.
Probably. I got to admit, I'm not an NBA guy. I knew Calderon. Once you got to Lowry, you lost me.
Yeah, sorry. I lost you.
Just not a fan of the NBA, but I am a fan of this game we got going on right now, the Kufla Championship, the Gataway Semifinals. And we've got a whistle going, a procedure call. It's going to be Brock possession. They trail by four with 16 minutes to go here in the fourth quarter. Any thoughts about what Brock can do in terms of trying to create some open lanes where they really haven't had a lot of, I mean, they've had some, Jeremy Snyder's been very good, but in this third quarter, Brock hasn't even really been testing him that much.
Yeah, well, if you look at the way they're set up right now, they don't really have anyone in the middle of the field, and when you can't create that traffic in front, so much of you know, lacrosse is about getting in those lanes and kind of creating havoc for the goalie and trying to, you know, maybe create some screens or whatnot down low. But Brock, they need to kind of clog that middle zone and maybe run some pick and rolls down low to create that space and generate some shots.
There's a shot. They get down into the close areas, and Gage Board just rips one a little bit past, going up high. Here comes Slade trying to create something, loses it under Van Galen's check and gets it back. Fakes the pass out. Now here comes Davis to set a screen, a little bit of a slip screen. Comes over to Davidson.
And we haven't seen much of Slade in that X position. It doesn't seem like they're going behind the net as much. And mostly just up top, kind of trying to cycle that ball around the 40-yard line.
And you've got to give some credit for that to David, to Ben Van Galen, who, again, having a tremendous game for them, for the Gryphons. There's a hard shot and a goal. That one, Travis Arch, once again, his second of the game. And he just spun and ripped it, bounces it far side past Jeremy Snyder to pull them back within three. Just what the doctor ordered for the Brock Badgers.
Yeah, just when we thought this game might be getting a little out of hand, well, not too out of hand, but, you know, maybe running away with it, Brock responds with a nice goal there.
They had to have the next goal. I mean, if you fall down five goals to this club with 14 minutes left, that's going to be tough. But now they're within three and a good chance to come back into it. See if Kroppen can come up with the faceoff. Van Galen pushing it ahead to himself and picking it up cleanly. He's running. Can he hold on to possession? Yes, nice job of pulling it out. Van Galen, what a game he had last night and another great one today. Here's Calvin Holland. He's going to give the ball off. Looks like he's going to head for a change. Connor Duchars gives it to Olbikas. Comes over to Taylor, to Serville. Serville up a little higher than his usual spot.
Yeah, no updates so far on Mark DeBrone. Haven't seen him out on the field yet, and I don't expect that we will.
No, he definitely looks like he was in a lot of pain, and that is a tough blow. A little bit of a collision there between a couple of the Brock defenders. Guelph in no hurry to move the ball inside. Duchars gets it back. Back to Olbikas. Olbikas goes to the net, shoots just a little bit high. What a great play. He did that earlier as well to create one of his own goals. A tremendous play.
Yeah, nice little spin up top and a good move down low as he shades off two defenders and just grazes that top left corner. We talked about the speed up front for the Guelph Gryphons, and they're very hard to contain. They'll burn you down low, and they'll also burn you on the outside. They can go around you. They can spin you off, and you have to be very conscious as a D-man, constantly shuffling your feet and keeping your stick active out front.
Guelph hanging on to the ball. It pops free, but they scoop it right back up. Ryan Serville in behind the net. Serville taking the pass from Jordan Critch. Critch back out to Brown. Oh, that pass just getting through to Curtis Knight. Olbikas takes it and fires it over to Duchars. He's going to take a look inside and then keep circling it around. Someone made an interesting point last night that one of the teams last night, when they were hoping to get a stall warning, weren't getting it because they kept going out and chasing the players. And the referees could say, look, they're not stalling. You're going out and chasing them. Here comes Knight towards the middle. Certainly Guelph not stalling at this point. But he was saying, you've got to pull back in and show that they're stalling if you want to get that. Guelph not going to be inclined to push towards the net if they don't have to. Although you can see every once in a while, they do take some forays into the middle. They're clogging up the middle right now. They got four guys in. There's Knight cutting.
Yeah, John Fitzgerald's done a really good job trying to contain Knight, though, on this possession at least. He's trying to force him to the outside, and Knight, you know, he'll hover around that 30-yard line and then make quick cuts down low, but Fitzgerald doing a good job staying in front of his man.
He's had a very strong second half, Fitzgerald. There's the stall warning now. Guelph's going to have to move the ball in. It comes back down. Attempt for a shot by a shot from Critch, and that one just takes off on him, flies out. He was trying to shoot the ball, and it took off out to about the 45-yard line. Guelph is saying it's their ball because they got to the sideline first. Curtis Knight has it, but it's, I believe the officials are going to have a discussion here to see if they think that was an attempt at a shot, because they are gathering together. The initial call has been Brock possession as Brandon Stahl ran over to pick that ball up. I think it was a shot. I think it just got away from him.
Yeah, I agree with you. And this is an interesting, actually, point that someone on the McGill team had made for me. Playing in your own stadium, obviously, a huge advantage. You have the home crowd and whatnot. But also, there's a lot of markers on this Molson field, a lot of, you know, signs and you know, advertisements and stuff like that. But a lot of players use that to their advantage.
Knowing where they are.
Exactly. And when they're wondering, you know, when they're running certain plays, they know where they need to hang out at, and they have their certain hot spots where they like to release balls from. Those are great markers out on the field to kind of help them get in the groove of their game.
Good point. It was determined that that was a shot that just went well wrong. So Guelph does retain possession. The stall warning went up immediately, but is now back down. Jordan Critch coming out from behind the net. Wrap check attempt by Fountain. We're going to have a flag. And that's going to be Matt Fountain, who's played maybe the best player on the field for the Brock Badgers today.
Yeah, absolutely. He's been all over the place, and a good active stick as well.
He's going to sit off for about 30 seconds now. Connor Duchars takes the ball. Guelph has a couple of players in the neighborhood of the goal. And the pass to Serville, who buries it.
Now, if you're Brock in this situation, do you pull the stick check? How late into the game would you, you know, try to develop a call such as that? Would you wait until, you know, the last couple of minutes of the game, or would
I'd say before the face-off right now? I think. I mean, if you're going to do it, I think now's the time to try it.
And, you know, as someone who's been around, you know, the league and the NLL and whatnot, how often do you see plays like that actually turning the tide of the game?
Well, it's more often in the field game, obviously. It's a more common call, and it can happen quite a bit. I mean, we just have to go back to last night, where the stick fouls against the Western Mustangs were absolutely critical in the win by the Queens Golden Gales.
And you'd think guys would just gets regulation size sticks. I mean, I don't know. I can't see, you know, in any other sport how a call like that ever being made. It's just, you know, it's just the nature of the beast here. I guess it's so easy to kind of get away with it in the game of lacrosse.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, they definitely, you know, it happens fairly often. There's so many things that can be a little bit off. And I mean, there was one last night where the ball just didn't come out of the pocket when the stick was turned upside down. So some of them are pretty easy.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, Brock opting not to go for it. They're going to try and do it on their own. And and Slade tries to slide out, and he's going to draw a penalty on Van Galen. So Van Galen will be off, and here's a chance for the Brock Badgers to get back into this one.
Yeah, and this is definitely going to be vital here for Brock. They got to get something going down 10-6 here with 8:19 left in the fourth quarter. Obviously, they would love to you know, sleep here in Montreal and get a good game in tomorrow for the Bagataway Cup Championship. So they're going to have to try to develop something. And if I were Brock, I would start working that down low game like we talked about earlier.
Yeah, I think they pretty much have to, but you know, it's not that they're not trying. There's a shot. They get the ball down. And Davis with the shot, that one goes wide. And you can see the sense of urgency as Gage Board, as Greg Davidson tracks that one down. Gets it back over the far side. The shot this time by Stahl. And we're going to see another flag.
A nice pass across, but a beautiful stop. And that's a defender laying low and taking the body, literally laying everything he has down on the line for his team. I don't know who that is exactly. I can't see the numbers, but
yeah, it's very difficult to pick out while he's lying on the ground there. But That's certainly not going to help them. Of course, they've still got Ben Van Galen. Their top defender is over on the in the penalty box. Certainly looking very uncomfortable. And that serves as a timeout for the Brock Badgers. So the score 10-6 with 7.5 minutes to go as we had a stoppage. And the player coming up, it is Matthew Lyons. Gets up on the floor, gets an appreciative round of applause from the fans who were pleased to see him get up. That's a couple of their main defenders who are now off the field, and that's a tricky situation. We saw that really bite Western last night when they had Patrick McCrory out of the game for a stick offense and an unsportsmanlike conduct for touching the stick before giving it to the official. He went out, Eric Petrie went out with a stick violation. And then Matt Spanger took a penalty. They had their three main starting long poles out of the game when Queens scored their three goals in the last 30 seconds.
And then, yeah, that's just a taking advantage of missed personnel out on the field, as like you said, Queens making a lot happen in the dying seconds of the game. And we talked about this a lot in the last game. It's like, how do you measure something like being, you know, a clutch team?
Yeah, we'll see if Brock can take advantage of it here. That ball's knocked away. Big play by Guelph. It's flying over to the sidelines. It should still be Brock possession, as it appeared to go off the Guelph defender, but still, that's going to kill a bit of the time on the penalty. Guelph needs to get through this one. There's another save by Jeremy Snyder, certainly a candidate for right there for their player of the game. He's played a very good game.
Yeah, Snyder going from left to right extremely quickly there and getting down low to block that shot as he's given his Guelph Gryphons a chance to kind of regroup here and say, okay, guys, we got a four-goal lead. Let's kind of draw things out a little bit and take our possession game to the next level by trying to really tire out these Brock players.
Here's Curtis Knight circling around behind his net. He's going to get a pick from Snyder. Knight's going to try and run past Davidson.
We're talking about from
Knight.
Yeah,
great job by Curtis Knight to get the ball up into the offensive zone.
And this is where Guelph can kind of play that waiting game.
Yeah, they can play possum. Now Knight's just going to cut to the net and take a shot and score. Curtis Knight, we talked earlier about it. He'll take what is available there. He was slowing things down. They came out to press him. He just ran by them, found an opening, and buries it.
Talking about a 120-yard play there. He's just making it all happen from his speed on the outside, dragging two defenders with him, and then getting open up top, kind of settling things down. All of a sudden, on his feet again, running in through the middle of the field and ripping one home.
Curtis Knight, such an essential player for this club, doing it all over the field. It's 11-6 with 5.5 minutes to go here in the fourth quarter. McGill comes up with the ball off the faceoff. They are in it, or Brock. Brock comes up. The red and whites throw
yeah,
me
yeah,
again.
It's hard telling with the uniforms. McGill has uniforms from a couple of years ago that look exactly like
very
that.
Very similar. Brock, though, with the ball. 5 goals behind, 5 minutes to go. It can be done. Oh, what a save by Jeremy Snyder, though. So many candidates for the outstanding player for this Guelph
club. Yeah, that was an absolute robbery.
And as I mentioned earlier, just to recap for anyone who didn't hear, Ben Van Galen was saying they used to let adversity get to them. They'd let things distract them from playing their game, and they have not let anything distract them. But right now, it's going to be a bit of a miscue by Snyder. The ball goes over to Brandon Slate, and he buries it.
Yeah, that's a fortunate play there for Brock. And, I mean, hey, this could be one of those momentum-shifting plays.
Yeah.
A bad play back in your own end, just a terrible giveaway in front. And, you know, Guelph, which has played so well on the back end throughout the majority of this game, just, you know, kind of let – that's a bit of a brain cramp there.
Yeah, let's see if Kyle Kroppen can keep the momentum going by getting a big win. This is where Van Galen can have a direct impact on changing that momentum by getting a faceoff win. It's going to be a procedure call. They're going to, on both sides, so they're going to line it up and do the draw again. They're down. The whistle goes. Kroppen gets the early advantage, but Van Galen keeps fighting for it. A dive effort to try and come up with the ball. And the Brock Badgers do get it. Here comes the long pole. John Fitzgerald. What a pass by Fitzgerald, the pass and the goal. What a shot by Kyle Davis. You talked about Slayton Davis not scoring. They've got the last two goals for Brock. And what a play. John Fitzgerald has been as good as anybody on the field in the second half of this game.
What a pass out in front. And just like you said, hey, all it takes is a couple of big plays. And just like that, Brock scores two quick ones, 11-8, inching their way back into this game. And with 3:18 left, could this be a mirror image of last night's tilt?
They were five goals down with 5 minutes to go. Now they're three goals down with 3 minutes to go. They are on pace.
Could this be the Cinderella, Bagataway Cup that everybody dreams of watching? It's all about the entertainment factor as well, folks. And people love watching entertaining games such as this.
Another scrambled draw. Both those guys really battling hard for it. Everyone going after the ball. Van Galen comes up with it, pops out, and he gets it. What a play by Ben Van Galen, the captain and leader of this club. A huge play. Ryan Serville is off to the side. Matt Fountain trying to get it away from him. And we have a timeout taken by the Guelph Gryphons. They're going to try and set things up and make sure they're all on the same page and know exactly what they want to do in this final 2:38 of the game. The clock will be stopping at this point. They probably won't run the stadium clock again as it will go down to the timekeepers. So we'll try and keep you updated if the announcer does announce how much time's left, but what a crucial moment here.
It's just interesting. There's so many things that can affect the outcome of a game. And you look at the momentum swings and whatnot. But Brock obviously scoring two big goals here in the last couple of minutes. And you're thinking, okay, let's say they do get back into this game and end up winning and going into tomorrow's game. After an emotional fourth quarter and getting back into things, it almost kind of takes the wind out of your sails a little bit going into a big championship matchup against a team that's essentially perfect.
Yeah, they have. I mean, McGill 11-0 on the season, and I'm sure the Guelph or Brock coaches, whoever does win this game, if it's Guelph can hold on, I'm sure their coaches will be taking a look at the video from today's game between McGill and Queens, especially the second half, to see what Queens was doing that was so effective against McGill. Part of it, admittedly, was McGill was playing all their players, going into their bench a bit, and if it's closer, you're not going to see as much of the bench players. But, I think they will be looking to see what things were effective and see if they can implement them tomorrow. Certainly, either of these teams is going to be a good test for the McGill Redmen.
And do we have an X factor here in the last 3 minutes of the game for this Brock side?
As much as you hate to say it, Mark DeBrone may well have been that guy, because he's the guy who can take it from defense and get it up on offense and help out. Are they going to be able to turn the ball over and get it quickly up into the other zone? That's the big question.
Well, I'm looking at Kyle Davis to make something happen. I've heard a little bit of noise from him so far in the last couple of minutes. Can he keep it up here in the fourth?
Connor Duchar is carrying the ball. He's going to go to the net, pass it behind. He's going to say it was a shot. Yeah, it's Guelph ball. I think Brock may be arguing that was a pass. I think it was actually maybe intended to be a pass, but he's firing it towards the net. You can see why it's called a shot. Curtis Knight running with the ball. Jordan Chris is going to get his first goal of the game. Makes it 12-8 as we are well into the final 3 minutes.
That's a bit of that one hurts a little bit. The goalie way out of his net there, and just a little easy tap in, if you will, for the Guelph Gryphons, making it a 12-8 ball game with three left.
There's not too much you can do about it. You have to go out and press. You have to take chances, and there's a very good chance that it's not going to go your way. I mean, that's why you're not playing that way earlier in the game when it's still close. You only do it when you definitely desperately have to. Now, you're asking earlier if it was time to hit the panic button. I think it's been hit by now. And they're going to pull out every stop they can. Again, Kropman fighting hard for the draw. Van Galen just kicks it over, but it's picked up. There's the shot and the goal by Kyle Davis.
And that's what you want. It's that transition from the offensive side of things to the defensive side. You want to bring your men with speed up with numbers, and that's what they did. A nice little passing play to the left side there, and leaves the left side of the net a little open for, I believe that was...
That was Kyle Davis.
That was Kyle Davis,
getting the pass
from
Gage Bord.
Who we just talked about. So.
Nice play by Gage Bord to come up with the ball off the faceoff. 12-9. Inside of a couple of minutes left to play.
And this is where your clutch players shine. And obviously Kyle Davis has scored some pretty big goals in his pass. So number 50, look for him in the last 3 minutes here.
Another big draw. Possession so critical here. And Kropman comes up with it. Brock has the ball, but it's knocked down onto the ground. A battle for it. We're going to have a push called. And it's Brock possession once again. So it's not over. The Badgers not giving in. Greg Davidson starts things up. They're going to get their offense set. They need to move in pretty quickly here. I don't know if I'd be spending quite so much time up at the 40-yard line. I think I'd be trying to work the play in, but here we go. Oh, what a strip.
Great active stick there. Holding onto the ball for a little too long, and here come the Brock players trying to double team as they need that ball back, and they need to get their possession game going in front of this net.
Van Galen very calmly flips that ball over to the goaltender, Snyder, and up they go on the far side, Matt Lyons.
And he's just going to run it down and waste some clock here.
And he throws the ball away, got a little pressure, and tried to make the pass over to Duchars. Brock has the ball. They still have an opportunity. They've still got some life. You can see if it's in the picture, you can see Ian Duffy well up around the 40-yard line to help with the clear. Here comes Brock. They've got it into the offensive zone. Davidson looking for someone in the middle to pass to. He's trying to create something, trying to make something happen. The ball is knocked loose. Kicked ahead by Van Galen. Knocked ahead with his stick, and Van Galen comes up with it. What a great play by Van Galen. He makes the pass off to Serville. It goes on the net to Taylor Brown, and Brown adds one, 13-9. That should be about the final nail in the coffin.
And, you know, we talked about taking risks, and right there was a perfect example of it. An individual effort on one side that leads to a goal on the other, and then you set up that one-on-one down low with the goaltender, and it's so hard for that goalie, you know, to try to get a read on that, where that shot's going to go in tight, and you know, making no mistake was Brown.
13-9, and we're really closing down into the final moments. We'll see when the clock comes out. The timekeeper with the clock is standing in front of the timekeeper's bench. She's getting ready to head out onto the field. We do have a Guelph player down back in his own zone. It was back down around the 30-yard line. He's up and being helped to the bench.
And, you know, it's interesting when you look at these rosters and the way that they're built. Obviously, you have your star power in your Kyle Davis and your Brandon Slade and Greg Davidson, guys that are scoring, you know, at least 45 points or more season in and season out. But then you look at this Guelph team with Ryan Serville, Jordan Critch, Curtis Knight, Connor Duchars. You got guys who are contributing on all sides, whether it's in the defensive side, the offensive side of things. You know, seven guys who are scoring in double digits for goals. They're kind of spreading the wealth around, and you love that. You can put guys in different positions, kind of play them around, you know, move them around in the X position, and it's a great way to kind of get your possession game going because you can trust the guys that are on the field, and you know that not all the offense is going to come out of one particular player.
Right, a lot of guys who can do a lot of things well. At this point, it's probably out of reach, but a big face-off for Brock if they can get it. It's their only chance. We have a procedure call, and it's going to be Guelph ball. And that's probably Kropman just getting a little bit overexcited and trying to get that one. You can't really blame him. There's the pass by Knight. Duffy is well out of the net. He heads back to his goal now. Pass out front. And we're going to have another goal for the Guelph Gryphons. This time it's number 24, Brendan Vogan, who's come in. And you might wonder why he's going to score a goal there when they're already up by four goals with the time running down. But he hasn't played very much today. I'm sure that's his first goal in a while. We'll have to check his stats on the season. But big chance for him to get a goal here late in the game. He was very excited about getting his chance. Lining up once again for the faceoff. They're down and set. There's the whistle and the big win. It's actually Jake Lambert taking the last couple of face-offs for Brock. It's going to be Brock possession. The clock is on the field. We're in the final 30 seconds of the 2013 Bagataway Cup semifinal. The Guelph Gryphons looking to close it out. Oh, shovel shot. Nice try by Brandon Stahl.
That would have been a pretty one.
It would have been. Slade takes it behind the net. He's going to pass it out to Davis, who loses the handle. He's behind the net. Passes it back out to Slade. Slade wants to let one rip. Flags flying everywhere. Slade gets a shot. The
save
by Snyder. Nice way to finish things off.
You know what? Brock didn't give up their quit, though. They were fighting to the very last second of this game, and you love to see that out of your club, especially, you know, even in a losing effort like this.
The score, 14-9 in the final seconds. I'm Stephen Stamp with Mark Amendiola. It's been our pleasure bringing you this semifinal game. Another save by Jeremy Snyder. The final whistle blows, and it is 14-9, the final score. The Guelph Gryphons have advanced to the Big Attaway Cup. They will face the McGill Redmen tomorrow.
And you love that, just absolutely showering the goaltender in high fives and love, because he played an absolutely spectacular game. I mean, we talked a lot about Duffy in the first, you know, the first quarter, but like you said, Snyder picking up the slack on the defensive side. And then just in that last little sequence, two or three huge saves, although obviously they didn't matter as much with a 14-9 win, still showing that he's got it in the late dying seconds and that every save counts for him.
Our players of the game for the Brock Badgers, number 17, the defender, Matt Fountain. You said it. He was all over the field, did a great job for them. Nice, solid effort for the Guelph Gryphons. Connor Duchars, one of many who were candidates. And I'll tell you, Curtis Knight, we could have, Ryan Treville, Jeremy Snyder, so many guys who played well. But Connor Duchars really played a key role. And the defender of the game from Guelph, number 7, David Nedelko, who had a very strong effort as well. And again, we could have gone with Ben Van Galen, who had a great game again, but Nedelko just seemed to shut down so much of that potent Brock offense.
And I got to give Curtis Knight the play of the game, if you will, for his about 100-yard rush up the field, shading those two defenders and making it look pretty on the inside. So
it's, you know, you could almost give player of the game for his team to Curtis Knight every game he's in.
Yeah.
He does so much all over the field. That will do it for this game at the Big Attaway Cup semifinal. Make sure you join us tomorrow for the 12:30 championship match between the McGill Redmen and the Guelph Gryphons. I'm Stephen Stamp for Mark Amendiola and the rest of the SSN crew. Thanks for being with us. We'll see you next time.